Good morning student, today we are going to discuss DNA sequencing gel and DNA footprinting assay. So in order to understand the DNA, what type of gel we use for DNA sequencing purpose, we will discuss little bit. So first thing is that we need to cast a slab gel. That means the gel are in between two glass plate. So before casting, we need to clean the plate and add some siliconizing agent so that the gel should not stick to one of the plate, okay? Because we need to take out the gel once the run is done. Then we need to cast the gel with the spacer. The gel thickness is depend on the spacer thickness. Now here is denaturing or non-denaturing gel. For sequencing purpose, we are going to cast a denaturing gel, remember. But here we are talking about the DNA is the sample we are going to run. So denaturation doesn't, we are not considering the protein here. So when we have considered the protein which will be in complete denaturing condition, then that time we have casted SDS page, we have discussed already. But for DNA sequencing gel, the denaturing agent is urea. So generally 8 to 12 molar urea we use for casting the denaturing sequencing gel. This is showing the native gel preparation, the TBE, tris borate EDTA buffer. This is a stock solution concentration. This is the other side is the final volume, how much you are going to cast. Depends on what type of molecule you are going to separate. You can control the acrylamide, bisacrylamide concentration. So polymerizing reagent is here, ammonium persulfate and timide is there. And then this is the preparation of denaturing gel. So we are using the buffer, TIS, borate and EDTA. So acrylamide, bisacrylamide solution, what percentage we are going to use for sequencing gel? It is a 4% polyacrylamide gel. Remember, this is a 4% gel we cast for DNA sequencing purpose, and it should contain 10 molar urea. Generally 8 molar to 10 molar, we can vary the amount. And polymerization agent is 10% ammonium persulfate we use, and with the help of timide. So timide actually start the catalyzation and formation of the free radical, and the free radical will catalyze the polymerization of acrylamide and bisacrylamide, and you know that the gel will be cast based on that gel will polymerize. Now mount the gel plate on the gel running apparatus, and 1x TBE buffer we use for run purpose. And for denaturing gel plate, we need a support aluminium plate in front of the glass plate. And pre-run, before we run the sample directly, we do a pre-run to warm the gel, okay? So after that, we will going to discuss a little bit about this in DNA sequencing, the Sanger's method, which we already studied in first semester. But this is called the chain termination sequencing. The sequencing reaction mix includes label, primer and template. So this is the template, what we are showing. The green color horizontal line is the primer. Primer is a small oligonucleotide, 10 to 20 base pairs, which sequence we know. And it is P32 label at the 5 prime end. That's what it is showing. And it has a free 3 prime hydroxyl site. Now, using this 3 prime the hydroxyl site, free site, we are going to allow it to polymerize, and they will use, this is the template, and you incorporate 1-1 base. And that's a technique with the help of DNA polymerase. So template area to be sequenced. This is the area we need to sequence. Now what we are, this is the chain termination sequencing, Sanger's method. So what we are going to use, we are going to use here, dideoxynucleotides are added separately to each of the four tubes. So this is a four tube reaction. We can see like this, chain termination Sanger sequencing. There are four tubes. In one tube, we are using all four DNTPs, like DATP, DGTP, DCTP, DTTP, all, but plus one extra, that is in a lower concentration, DDATP. Like that, in four tubes, we have taken DDCTP, DDGTP, DDTTP. So what is the function of this dideoxy? It has, it doesn't have any hydroxyl group in 2', 3' sequence of the ribose. So chain cannot, polymerization takes place 5', 3', you know that. So 3' hydroxyl group is very important for polymerization. Here there is no 3' hydroxyl group free, so polymerization will terminate if they reach this kind of NTPs. So probability is there because we are giving the DNTPs, that is the normal DNTPs also we are giving, and one DDNTP we are giving. So there is a probability how much the occurrence of this thing will give the chain will terminate at different position. That's why if A is there, if the normal A goes here, it will continue the entire length. But if it encounter a DDA, so chain will terminate here. Like that, there are so many C. So if it is last C it encounters, so it will chain terminate here. Before that, there is one more C. Before also, there is one more C. And 1, 2, 3, third is also another C. So the probability is there when it will encounter a DDCTP, that during that polymerization time, it will stop the chain synthesis at that point. Now, how after doing the four-tube reaction, we need to load the four-tube in an polyacrylamide gel, what we have prepared, 4% polyacrylamide gel with what? With urea, 8 to 10 molar urea. So this is the typical DNA sequencing gel, a slab gel we have already prepared. And then we are loading the the four tubes here. And we are going to read from bottom to top. The sequencing here, the last is the G. So sequencing, we will read G, T, A, C. Like that it will be going from bottom to the top band. Like it will end with G. So this is a single fragment we are sequencing. Most of cases, how people used to clone in a previous time. Now the PCR has come and we can directly sequence the PCR product. But there was a time when each fragment we are going to sequence, we need to clone in a vector. So M13 is a filamentous virus. Generally, this filamentous circular single strand DNA we use as a vector. So M13, what you are seeing here, this is a vector, a circular DNA molecule where we have cloned our DNA. This is the DNA fragment which have cloned. Now, origin of replication of M13. Again, M13 is a filamentous bacteriophage. People have developed vector based on M13. It is a circular single-stranded DNA. It has a circular single-stranded DNA. So even though it is a horizontal line, you should imagine, so it is a circle. In that region, they have cloned your gene of interest, that is the clone DNA here. So we have designed a primer, which is P32 level at the end. Now, which is the primer? Primer they have designed from the origin of the replication sequence of M13. Now, if we give the DNA polymerase, it will, polymerization will start, and the DDNTP, how much you are giving, based on that it will terminate the that sequence. So again, it is a four tube reaction. You can use the primer his label, and this is the probability GATC. This is four tube reaction, and after that you are doing an electrophoresis. So this is electrophoresis gel. What is this? You can prepare you can cast the gel with the comb, or after casting, you can insert this kind of comb. This is called shark's tooth comb. And then in between, you can load your sample. So there are two things. During casting only, you are fixing the comb, which we generally do. But sometimes we don't need to use the comb in the beginning. So after the gel is solidified, then we are inserting the shark tooth comb. And again, we are loading the sample GCAT, that the way they have loaded, and then the band will appear black color, because you have to do an autoradiography, and you will get the black color band which you need to read from bottom to top. Now, this is the Sanger's method of DNA sequencing. The dye terminator sequencing is the new method developed based on the same principle. Here the difference is that a distinct dye or color is used for each of the four DDNTP. Now, earlier we have seen our primer is label, but here we are using a fluorescence dye, different color we are using for DDNTP. Since the terminating nucleotides can be distinguished by color, all four reaction can be performed in a single tube. This is the big advantage. That means no need to run for four tubes. This is four tube reaction we are doing in one tube, because here my dioxy, those bases are color coded. Now, diterminator sequencing, what we are doing, this is the old model where we have to, four tube reaction, we have to load GATCH sample separately. But here we are not doing one gel, we are in one gel, in one lane, we are actually loading the sample. So there is no need to perform a four tube reaction, one tube reaction is enough here. Why? Because all bases are differently different color coded dideoxy we are using here. So, and now this is a capillary. First it was a slab gel. Yes, we have done a slab gel, and I discussed also that we can cast polyacrylamide gel in a tube. So capillary tube also you can cast your polyacrylamide gel, the same 4%, very small, very thin gel. And then this is with a denaturing agent, and this is can be a scanner can detect this all color coded, fluorescently colored tagged dyes, and an electrophorogram will be generated based on each color. So each nucleotides are colored, like A is in a green color, G is a black color, T is a red color, C is a blue color. So like that, if it is color coded, you can, each peak will determine the each nucleotide. So reading is not here the band we are reading. We are reading here an electrophorogram. Each peak will be represented by different color, and that will be that representing each basis here. So it's a very easier technique compared to the previous one. So the next topic we are going to discuss, that is called DNA footprinting. You need to remember this thing in your, when you are studying the molecular biology. So the thing is that, imagine a sequence of DNA here, which is already 5' P32 level, and there is a regulatory sequence. What is a regulatory sequence? This is a sequence of DNA where a protein can come and bind. Okay, so there is a regulatory protein can come and bind here. So protein will be present in a cell extract. So I am going to do two tube reaction. In one tube I am going to take this DNA fragment, and I am incubating with the cell extract. Hopefully my regulatory protein is present in the cell extract, that will come and bind to this regulatory sequence. But another tube, which I mentioned, it is a control. So in the control reaction, what I will do, I will only incubate the DNA fragment. So I will not incubate with the cell extract. So there is no protein present, nobody will come and bind this thing. At this condition, I want to treat this to, so this is the ideal situation. We can imagine that the protein is present in the regulatory sequence, it is bounded in that region. But here, as there is no, I'm not incubating with the cell extract, so no proteins are coming and binding to the regulatory sequence, nobody is there. At this condition, if I treat both these molecules with the DNase 1 is an enzyme which will cut the double-stranded DNA and produces different small fragment. If you incubate with more time with DNase 1, it can chew up in the nucleotides, single nucleotide also it can release. But if you restricted time, if you do it, it will break the DNA at random position. So what will happen if I treat this molecule and this molecule with DNase 1? So it cut the DNA fragment. So whenever he finds that there is a free DNA fragment, it will cut. What will happen? The control will be chewed, different size fragment will be getting. But here what will happen, this is also get cut, the test one also get cut, but the protein where the regulatory protein is coming and bounded the regulatory sequence, because of this binding, it will inhibit the DNase 1 function. That means that portion will be protected. Understand that thing? So because the protein is bounded at the regulatory site, so what is happening, the DNase 1 cannot show activity because of this protection, and the control one, there is nothing is protecting the regulatory sequence, so everything will be subjected to DNase 1 action. Now if we treat both the tubes, now run in a denaturing gel, again I want to use the denaturing gel, the same 4% with urea polyacrylamide gel, a slab gel. What we are getting, an autoradiography, what we will see in the minus, that is the control, as different fragments will be generated because DNase 1 cut the whole length, whole DNA in a small, small fragment. So you will going to see a ladder. But what will happen in the test where the regulatory protein has bounded? You will get some fragment, but the big fragment will be missing. Why this is missing? Because this is missing because the protein, regulatory protein, is coming and bounded, and because of that there is a protection. So that is the But in the control, what you are going to see, this footprint, that's the name, that's why the name came, this footprint bands are still there. So this is the sequence where the regulatory protein has come and bound, which we are comparing with the control, and we are getting the sequence back. Exactly the same thing. This picture I have taken from Lellinger book. So the same thing, double-stranded. It is definitely, this is also double-strand DNA. This is also double-strand DNA. So after, this is a controlled reaction. This is negative. This is a control. This is a minus plus. So what is happening in the control? You are going to get the complete ladder, but in the test, what we are going to see, the missing bands indicate where the protein, here protein is RNA polymerase, was bound to DNA. So this experiment generally we do in order to find the promoter sequence where RNA polymerase come and bind. What is the promoter sequence? The promoter sequence is the sequence present in the DNA where RNA polymerase as an enzyme which come and binds and start initiate transcription, that means from DNA to RNA synthesis. So this is a technique, not only RNA polymerase, there are many protein who comes and bind DNA. If you want to identify which is the sequence it comes and bind, you can do this kind of assay, and with the help of this comparison with the test and the control, you can find which bands are missing. As these bands are missing and this band and the same bands are present in the control, this is the footprint of the bands which are missing. So that's why this is referred as a footprinting assay of RNA polymerase binding site. So this technique can be used in different protein and DNA when they are interacting. We can also determine which protein is binding which regulatory sequence. Thank you very much.